I'd like to welcome you to a night, very special night, an evening of conversations and music with Billy Joel.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. I'm sure you got questions. And what I find in this kind of situation is people ask questions that people who write for newspapers or radio people don't normally ask. I get all kinds of interesting questions, and I feel like sometimes I'm actually helping somebody. I'm answering a question that's relevant to their life for the rest of their life. If you got a question, just raise your hand. I'll try to get to everybody, and we'll just go until it really gets stupid, all right? This gentleman right here. Right down here. And
your music is very eclectic. Who are your major influences? Could you list me maybe five of your major influences?
I had to pick him, right? Okay. Thank you for saying that it is eclectic, because that's something I strive to be. Probably the biggest influence in my life was classical music originally. And the Beatles really synthesized what I wanted to do. Because that would be the single biggest moment that I can remember being galvanized into wanting to be a musician for life, was seeing the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan Show. Now, I didn't have a television when I was growing up, which is funny because my father actually worked for a television company, Dumont. I don't know if anybody heard of Dumont. And we had a little Levitt house, and the Dumont was on the rack, and you pull it out of the wall, and it broke when I was about five. And my mother and my father split up, and nobody fixed the TV, so that was the end of TV. It was just like this big glass thing on the wall, you know. And so I listened to classical music, and I always loved music. I was enchanted by music. I would have to say Beethoven would be my favorite classical composer. Beethoven was Titanic, you know. He lived for me, breathed music. You know, he ate music, he shit music. I mean, this guy was like, everything was music with this guy. I understand he didn't even leave his house a lot of the time. He's just like, don't bother me. It's a nice day, fuck a nice day. Writing, come on out, come on. Can Ludwig come out? You know? So Beethoven was, you know, big influence on me. Mozart, Chopin, Debussy. I mean, that's in classical music. But the Beatles, I'm over this guy's house. This guy, I was going to say friend of mine. He really wasn't a friend of mine. I hung out with him because he had a TV. Right? I was a Machiavellian little kid, you know. Yeah, Greg, yeah, I really like you, Greg. Let's watch TV. Greg Hicks, his name was. In Hicksville, this was. So I'm over his house, and the Beatles come on TV. Now, you got to understand, this is in something like February of 1964. John F. Kennedy, the president, had been assassinated in November of 1963. The country was in a funk, and we had the blues. I mean, for this man to be taken away, this young, vigorous, vital man who represented youth and progress and the future was snatched from us. And the country really had the blues. And who became the president?
Lyndon Johnson. You know, politics as usual, you know.
And
I speak to you tonight with a heavy heart and big ears, you know.
And it was like, this man didn't capture anyone's imagination like the way Kennedy did. So all of a sudden, now this is also in an era, Hollywood tried to take control of rock and roll. They understood that young people like rock and roll. Hey, the young kids like the rock and roll stuff. Why don't we cook up a couple of rock stars right here in Hollywood? We'll find a nice looking boy with a great big pompadour, and we'll put him out there, and we'll get some snappy tunes, and he'll be a big hit rock star. And you know, you had Frankie Avalon and Fabian and, you know, Annette Funicello, you know, and they were putting Elvis in these awful movies, you know, clam bake, well, it's a clam, and like everybody liked Elvis was like, what the hell happened to this guy? And also, this is during the Civil Rights Movement, and a lot of radio would not play really good rhythm and blues. It was Jackie Wilson was out, and Otis Redding, and Wilson Pickett, James Brown, but they weren't playing this stuff on white radio. Why?
It got the kids all too sexed up, got them all excited. They're going to want to do that grind dance, you know?
So they tried to pretty it up. They tried to sanitize it. They come out with Frankie Avalon and Fabian and Bobby Rydell and all these boring bullshit guys. And all of a sudden, there's this band with hair like girls, you know? It was, really wasn't, but to us, their hair looked like hugely long, you know, 1964. And they played their own instruments and they wrote their own songs. And they didn't look like Fabian. They looked like these working class, like kids like we all knew. And John Lennon had this look when he was on Ed Sullivan, like, fuck all of you, you know? This is such total bullshit to me. And we knew, you could tell, he said, yeah, I know, that guy, you know? And I said at that moment, I said, that's what I want to do. I want to do that. That's what I want to do. I want to be like those guys. I didn't ever think I'd be like the Beatles, but I wanted to be a professional musician. So that's a big influence. Jazz musicians, I would say Dave Brubeck, who came out with an album, I think it was in the late 50s, early 60s, called Time Out, who messed with time. You know this song, I'll show you. Two, three, four, five. One, two, three, four, five. Now try to keep 5/4 time, right? It's tough, but I figured out how to do that eventually. I was taught it by a jazz musician. He said, "I'll give you an idea how to think in terms of 5/4 time." Now most songs are like 4/4 time, like "My Funny Valentine," "Sweet Comic Valentine." Here's how you make it 5/4 time. My funny fucking Valentine, sweet comic fucking Valentine. Now maybe that's what they were doing. I don't know. It's adding a beat, but he did stuff in 7/4, 12/8, 9/3, 7½, 2/4. You know what's the one? This one. Signature is that. I got it. And then he goes to this other thing. So. And this guy was messing with, what was that thing in, what movie was that? What movie was that? Network. You ever seen Network? And the guy, Peter Finch, I'm mad as hell, I'm not going to take it anymore. And he meets with the head of the whole conglomeration who owns the network. He says, you have messed with the elemental forces of nature. That's what Dave Brubeck was doing with Time Out, you know? Where's the rhythm? So that was a big influence. So classical, Beatles, jazz. You wanted five? I'll make up another two. R&B, rhythm and blues, would have to be the biggest, like that period before the Beatles, the only thing I was hanging on to was Ray Charles, man, James Brown, Sam and Dave, Wilson Pickett. The original rock and roll was made by African American people, which is funny now because when a band like Living Color comes out, they go, oh, how odd, a black group doing rock and roll, you know? Gee, Jimi Hendrix, what, isn't that strange, a black man doing rock and roll, you know? They invented it, so R&B, I loved that stuff. That was, you know, when, I think my hormones were kicking in when I first heard R&B and realized what the rhythm aspect of it meant, you know? I didn't get the blues till later. And another influence would be actually Broadway shows. My mother took us to, we lived on Long Island, and we couldn't get into the city. Long Island. My mother took me to Westbury Music Fair, right? Westbury Music Fair, you could see Pajama Game, Guys and Dolls, My Fair Lady, Music Man, and it was fun. You know, it seemed a little, you know, old to me, but I appreciated the songwriting aspect of it. I appreciated the work that went into those things, and I went away singing those songs. And you got to remember, in the early '60s, in the late '50s, all the top albums were not rock and roll albums. They were not Frank Sinatra albums. They were Broadway show albums. Those were the big hits: My Fair Lady, Camelot, South Pacific. They were huge, huge recordings. So I think that's five. Okay. Now we're gonna go to that person. I promised I will not forget. I shall return. I'll be back.
How did you decide to frame scenes from an Italian restaurant, and which part came first?
Okay. Did anybody hear that? How did I decide to frame scenes from an Italian restaurant, and which part came first? That's a good question. That song started out as the middle part. It was called The Ballad of Brenda and Eddie. Brenda and Eddie were the populist daddies and the king and the queen of the brown. Play. Okay. I'll just take my cue from the audience. It's time for a little musical interlude, Bill. And I think we debuted this part in Philadelphia at the something like the Academy of Music or something. And it goes, Brenda and Eddie were the popular studies and the king and the queen of the prom, riding around with the car top down and the radio on. Nobody looked any finer. Oh, it's more of a hint at the Parkway Diner. We never knew we could want more than that out of life. Surely Brenda and Eddie would always know how to survive. Oh, 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 oh. Brenda and Eddie were still going steady in the summer of 75 when they decided the marriage would be at the end of July. Everyone said they were crazy. Brenda, you know you're much too lazy, and Eddie could never afford to live that kind of life. Oh, but there we were waving Brenda and Eddie goodbye. Oh, oh, oh. Well, they got an apartment with deep park carpet, a couple of paintings, some Sears, a big water bed that they bought with the bread they had saved for a couple of years. They started to fight when the money got tight, and they just didn't count on the tears. Oh, Brenda and Eddie had it already by the summer of 75, from the height of the low to the end of the show for the rest of their lives. They couldn't go back to the greasers. The best they could do was pick up their pieces. So we always knew they would both find a way to get by. Oh, and that's all I heard about Brenda and Eddie. Can't tell your mom as I told you already. And here we are waving Brenda and Eddie goodbye. Oh, 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 oh. And I had some kind of bailout ending. Oh, 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 oh. You know, one of those bailout endings. You know, how do we end this thing? It's just give it an end. So I said, okay, that's the Ballad of Brenda and Eddie, which is kind of the meat and potatoes, you know, the main course. I use a lot of food analogies. I'm a food-oriented guy. And so what I was trying to get across was, we all know, I'm sure, that there were people who peaked a little too early in life. When we were in high school, there was the people we thought were so cool in high school. Like, I wish I was that guy in high school, you know, with the perfect pompadour, you know, he always had great clothes, you know, he always got the coolest shoes, he always went out with the coolest girl, you know, he was always the most popular guy, and then I saw him at the 10-year reunion, and this guy was like a caved-in ashtray, you know what I mean? Stomach was like out to here. What the hell happened to you? It's like, peak too early, you know? You know, we all know people like this, and I always wonder, whatever happened to the heroes of high school? Because in high school, it was so important to be with the right crowd. In my era, maybe it's the same in this era. I'm assuming there's a certain amount of that still goes on. Bullshit, you know? And I thought, you know, but they were my heroes, these people. And then I said, okay, but that's not enough. That's not enough. We got that. We got the meat and potatoes. Now, what context is this coming from? Am I being preachy? Am I putting somebody down? And I thought, and I had this other idea, which was this bottle of white, bottle of red. I said, this is a good introduction. It's really not a song in itself. It's a prelude to something. And I took a cue from, remember the Abbey Road album by the Beatles? Anybody know that? Okay. Move again. I should just kind of stay. This the side two of Abbey Road is this thing called Golden Slumbers, right? And it goes. Now the Beatles really hadn't kind of hung out together for a long time when they made this album. And what I suspect is they came in with little bits and pieces of things. And McCartney had this idea, you never give me your money, you only send me your funny paper. And in the middle of negotiations, you break down. And then the next part it goes, and they go, now what do you got? Well, I don't know. And he said, what's that other idea you had? Head job, money spent, zero future, zero rent. So that was, then, and George Martin figured out, he says, if you just make this one chord change, you could go right into that. All the money's gone, nowhere to go. And then what? What are you going to do now? Well, let's see. I got this, and John would kick in. I got this idea. But oh, that magic feeling, nowhere to go. Take it piece by piece. One sweet dream. Now, come on, he didn't write that all in one sitting. That was all. Pick up the bag, get in a limousine. Soon we'll be an old man. But then there's the drum solo. Ringo, what do you want to do? And I think what happened was they had a lot of great pieces of things, and George Martin being the brilliant producer that he was, and having the terrific relationship that he had with the Beatles, who were not getting along with each other at all, sewed it all together and turned it into one piece. Almost a symphonic piece, because it's a reiteration when they go da, 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 at the end, and we all go, they meant to do the whole thing like this, you know. And it's kind of it's a device, and it worked, and we, you know, we all, those of us who grew up then, just like idolized the Beatles so much, we thought this was like Beethoven's Ninth that was all conceived in one piece. But it wasn't. It was done in different times, and that's how I wrote that song. Just so there's no mistaking, you know? Okay, let's turn on the light. Oh, it's like La Scala here. Okay, we're gonna go over to this side, where we haven't been yet. Yeah, let's come down all the way in the front here.
On the last album, was it a tough adjustment working with a different drummer?
Okay, good question. Yes, it was. I worked with a producer, a guy named Danny Korchmar, who didn't want to work with Liberty. He didn't want to work with the bass player I was working with at the time. He wanted to try a bunch of different musicians. The musicians I was used to working with are rock and roll musicians. They don't really play groove stuff. Rock and roll time goes all over the place. Rock and roll is like not a matter of how consistently you come down on, you know, like a clock. It's how hard you hit it. You know, it's my Liberty, I think, is thinking of his ex-wife every time he hits the drums. Because the drums are like, they're destroyed. Every night there's sticks, woods flying all over the stage. These things made out of like titanium are broken, you know? And he's got to deal with this drum company. I said, can't the drum company give you shit that doesn't break? You know, you're like representing them, and the drums are like flying off. Bang! And I said, oh, I'm sick of that alimony. Bang! You know? And but he's not essentially a groove player. He's not a clock. He's not a timekeeper. He is for us the timekeeper, but it's his way of conducting. Now, Danny wanted to work with a groove drummer, so I worked with Zach Alford, who would work for the B-52s. He played for Springsteen. He's played for a bunch of people. He's a very good drummer. Steve Jordan, who was a genius on the drums, one of the most natural musicians that I've ever met. This guy, T.M. Stevens, who plays the bass in a very unique way. He literally hits the bass like a percussion instrument. He doesn't pluck strings. He's one of those guys. And I said, this is very, very different for me, but let me go with it. And it took some adjusting, but I think Danny had a vision for the album, which I didn't have. I don't think like a producer so much. I think when I'm in the studio, like a writer, you know? I still like the song. I don't want to do it 50 times. Believe me, when you're in a recording studio and you do, let's do another take. Okay, I'll do another take. Let's just do another take. Okay, I'll do another take. And then like 20 times, why don't you just do another take? You really start, I hate this song. I wish I never wrote the fucking song. You know, if it was a good song, I wouldn't have to do 20 fucking takes. I must be a piece of shit. Eventually, you know, so when I'm recording, you know, we get to the second take or the third take, say I'm the producer, because I started recording this last album on my own. I was the producer. It was like, ooh, I'm a jumbo shrimp, you know what I mean? The writer is going to be the producer, you know? We get to like two takes, and I think, yeah, that's close enough. Let's not like wound too tight here, you know? Let's quit while we still like the thing. You know what I mean? How does it sound in the playback? Well, I know it's kind of close to what I was thinking. Yeah. I don't hate it yet. It's fine. Now Danny was a producer, and I usually work good in tandem with another set of brains to bounce off of and argue with and fight with and get violent with. But there's a lot of people who work better like that. So it took some adjusting, and I'm glad I tried it, and it's opened the option to me of working with other musicians in the future. And I think a writer does owe it to himself to hear his work interpreted by different types of musicians. And I'm not afraid of it anymore because of that. So I'm not going to do Piano Man yet, so we need some more good questions here. Let's go to the middle part of the balcony. I'll come down here again.
I actually have two questions. I was wondering...
Oh.
First of all, in your song Vienna, I was wondering why you chose Vienna as that city, if that city specifically. And I was wondering the inspiration behind Summer Highland Falls.
Okay. Two different questions. Two questions in one. The first one was about Vienna. Why did I write about that particular city? And what was the inspiration behind the song Summer Highland Falls? Okay. It's kind of a tale of two cities question. Okay, the first one, why did I pick Vienna to use as a metaphor for the rest of your life? Okay, my father lives in Vienna now. My father moved back to Europe. Him and my mother split up. My father, I had to track him down. I didn't see him from the time I was 8 till I was about 23, 24 years old. He lives in Vienna, Austria, which I thought was kind of bizarre, because he left Germany in the first place because of this guy named Hitler, and he ends up going to the same place where Hitler hung out all those years, you know. And I thought, he's really got to love Europe to live here, because this Vienna, also for a long time was the crossroads. During the Cold War, between the Eastern Bloc, between the Warsaw Pact nations and the NATO countries, was the city of Vienna. And what's his name? Orson Welles did a movie called The Third Man. Everybody ever see this movie? With that ding 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 ding. It was all about this, you know, spying, and Vienna was always the city. It was the crossroads. It was the crossroads between the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish Empire, and the Holy Roman Empire. Vienna was always a crossroads city. So the metaphor of Vienna, you know, has the meaning of a crossroads. It's a place of intercourse. Okay. Of exchange. It's a place where cultures commingle, and fluids and things. Wine. Okay. You get great beer in Vienna, but you also get like brandy from Armenia. You know. I mean, it was one of those places where cultures commingled, and this is a filthy audience. I'm purely. So I go to visit my father in Vienna, and I'm walking around in this town, and I see this old lady. She must have been about 90 years old, and she's sweeping the street. And I say to my father, "What's this nice old lady doing sweeping the street?" He says, "She's got a job. She feels useful. She's happy. She's making the street clean. She's not put out to pasture. You know, we treat old people in this country pretty badly. We put them in rest homes. We kind of kick them under the rug, and we make believe they don't exist. And, you know, let them worry about their health care benefits, and, you know, screw them. We don't want to pay any attention to them. They've had their day." Well, they don't feel like that. And a lot of these older places in the world where the culture is older than ours, they value their older people. And the older people feel like they can still be a part of the community. And I thought, this is a terrific, idea that old people are useful. And that means I don't have to worry so much about getting old, because I can still have a use in this world in my old age. And I thought, Vienna waits for you. You know, I knew people when I was saying, "Slow down, you crazy child." Oh, let me play that one. That's a good song. Actually, I have this in my book. See this book? Look at this thing. It's got a table of contents in it and everything. I'm impressed. No, I wrote all this shit. All right, let's see. Where is it? It would be under V, right? T. Oh, look at this. I got to turn the page, the table of contents, to find it. Page 213.
Turn to page 213.
They didn't number the pages. Back there it is. Gotta be in the V. Okay. W, X, Y, Z. So it's before that. Okay. There it is. Okay.
Child, you're so ambitious for a juvenile, but then if you're so smart, tell me, why are you still so afraid? Where's the fire? What's the hurry about? You better cool it off before you burn it out. You got so much to do and only so many hours in a day. Truth is told, you can get what you want, or you can just get old. You're gonna kick off before you even get halfway through. Ooh, when will you realize Vienna waits for you? Slow down, you're doing fine. You
can't be everything you wanna be before your time. Although it's so romantic on the borderline tonight. It's too bad, but it's the life you lead. You're so ahead of yourself that you forgot what you need. Though you could see where you're wrong, you know you can't always see when you're right. You're right. You got your passion, you got your pride, but don't you know that only fools are satisfied? Well, dream on, but don't imagine they'll all come true. Ooh, when will you realize Vienna waits for you?
This is the accordion solo. It's hard to imitate an accordion.
Disappear for a while. It's all right, you can afford to lose a day or two. Ooh, 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 ooh. When will you realize Vienna waits for you? And you know that when the truth is told, that you can get what you want or you can just get old. You're gonna kick off before you even get halfway through. Ooh, 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 when will you realize Vienna waits for you? When will you realize Vienna waits for you?
There's also a lot of inside stuff musically on that. So the beginning of it and the end. I don't know if you know of a composer named Kurt Weill, who wrote the Three Penny Opera. It's very Kurt Weill, I thought. I was trying to get that kind of sick, you know, middle European, kinky, decadent thing, you know. Money, 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 you know, the cabaret kind of, you know, there's a lot of crazy stuff going on. I mean, we're seeing the result of it in this ethnic warfare in the Balkans right now, which is the tragedy, because this century started out with the assassination of this archduke in Sarajevo, and that begat World War I, which begat the Russian Revolution, which then you had the Depression, and then that begat World War II, and then that begat the Cold War, and here, and it's all that other shit is over, but they're still blowing each other to smithereens in Sarajevo. And that's how the century started out. So this is this whole thing going on in Middle Europe, which is this Kurt Weill, I thought, and some composers, Dvorak, Smetana, they captured it that.
Come, meine Liebchen, you know, kind of that little, you know.
But they're, you know, at least they're out front about it. You know, you go to England, the English are like, the English are all very proper. You know, they have their little umbrellas, and they have their little, you know, civil rose suits. And then every night they go home and spank each other. Because it's so naughty, you know. The Middle Europeans are out front.
Yeah, I am a kinky fellow, you know. Yeah, with the patch on the eye, you know.
The other song you asked about was Summer Highland Falls. Okay. Wait, that's in the S section. This is that. I lived actually in a town upstate New York, right on the Hudson, just below West Point. And it's called, and it's Highland Falls. And I lived there, and it was at a time I was in a relationship which was, you know, the bloom was off the rose, the honeymoon was over. And you realize how disappointing it can be when you love somebody so much and then you're mean to each other and you do hurtful things to each other, you know, all out of love, but it's, you know, that first understanding that all's not right, you know, something is rotten in Denmark, you know, and there is, you know, and you either accept it and you say, okay, maybe we're not as perfect as we thought we were. There's a certain disappointment, but there's also an acceptance in this. So I was looking for one of those yin-yang kind of things. Anyway, it's called Summer Highland Falls. I don't think I ever say Summer Highland Falls in the song at all. But it's, you know, like, I always thought it was so cool that Bob Dylan wrote a song called Rainy Day Woman Number 13, and nowhere in the song did it have anything to do with Rainy Day or Woman Number 13. You know? Okay.
They say that these are not the best of times, but they're the only times I've ever known. And I believe there is a time for meditation in cathedrals of our own. Now I have seen that sad surrender in my lover's eyes, and I can only stand apart and sympathize. For we are always what our situations hand us. It's either sadness or euphoria. So we'll argue and we'll compromise and realize that nothing's ever changed. For all our mutual experience, our separate conclusions are the same. Now we are forced to recognize our inhumanity. Our reason coexists with our insanity. And though we choose between reality and madness, it's either sadness or euphoria. Fantasies, and as we stand upon the ledges of our lives with our respective similarities, it's either sadness or euphoria.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. It occurred to me, and I was asked the other day, I did an interview with a guy in the Trenton Times. I had played Princeton University 20 years ago. I was the opening act for Jay Giles, the Jay Giles band. Well, I did a whole tour with these guys. And this was like a full tilt blues rock boogie band, the Jay Giles band. First I look at the purse, the bats do the bop. First I look at the purse, the bang. Everybody's boogie! And it's like, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome. And they're all going, Boogie, Billy Joel.
Who?
What? And this guy, sing us the song of the piano man. Like, boo! Boo, get him off the stage now. It's like, what's that Albert Brooks album? Memoirs of an Opening Act. Richie, Richie, Rich. Anyways, get him off. Somebody else is here. Boo, kill, you know? So we had to get good, like, real quick. You know? So we opening up night after night, boo, we started looking at each other and go, I guess we better do some boogie stuff, you know? So we, you know, you got to get good quick in those situations. Anyway, what I would like to take a question from, just so I can direct something here, because everybody wants to direct, is anyone who is considering a career in music, whether it's as a writer, as a musician, as a singer, as a recording person, somebody in the music business, because you're going to get a lot of discouragement. Everybody's going to tell you you're crazy, you shouldn't do it. When are you going to get a real job? When are you going to grow up? You're nuts. And I'm an example of somebody who did one of those crazy-ass things, and actually there are guys I know who had regular straight jobs, and they're all out of work. And I'm still doing, you know, just kind of trucking along, Billy Joel, rock star, you know. So it's funny. I actually made a cockamamie career out of this crazy gig. But so if there is anyone, I'd like to take a question from them now, if I can help you in any way. Yes, right here, this woman with the red top.
I was just wondering what you think about the music industry today compared to when you got started, and what piece of advice would you give someone who wanted to get started now?
Okay, good question. The music business today as opposed to when I got started. Okay, when I got started, it was in the 60s. I was in my first band, 64. Everything was wide open. It was an outlaw business. Everyone was an entrepreneur, in a sense. Everyone was defining and discovering what the music business really was when I first started out. It was the era of the Beatles, and they were signing up everybody. Everybody was being signed up. Right? You got long hair? You're up. You got long hair? Let's sign them up. You know? Oh, they're cute. Let's sign them up. Oh, they're kind of poppy, poppy. Let's sign them up. Everybody got signed up and dumped, you know, within 2 or 3 years if they didn't have a hit. There was like a gazillion groups originally. There was AM radio was actually playing rock and roll. Now it's talk radio. Radio is completely different. FM, the idea of FM hadn't even hit yet. FM hit in the mid-60s. And all of a sudden you heard this big fat sound coming over the radio, and jocks. The jocks are all talking like that, and they just got like everybody be like, it's just it's like starting to smoke pot back then. Like, well, you know, yeah, we're gonna play the new Quicksilver Messenger Service side 2 is coming up at 1 p.m. And those of you who are like still unstoned or you know, you're gonna have to listen to commercials for a while. Anyway. Everything was, it was wide open. It was, anything could happen. You were literally an outlaw if you went into the music business. And it, in a way, look, there was still ripping off going on. The music industry, let's have no delusions, is not the Girl Scouts. It is somewhat of a larcenous, like any other industry is. No different than real estate, no different than television, no different than Wall Street. It's a business. It's meant to make money, ultimately. But there are people in the music business, in record companies, who love music, who want to discover talent, who want to claim having found somebody. That's the most exciting thing in the music industry. The big wigs make money because they're the big wigs and they're sitting on the top. But there's a lot of people who are not at those big executive levels who really want to discover new talent, who want to be the person who found the next Bob Dylan, the next Bruce Springsteen, the next Pearl Jam. That's the most exciting aspect, I think, for a lot of people in the music business. Despite all the cynicism, that there is. There are still those people who go into the music, who go into record companies, hoping to be able to find that. So that element hasn't changed. It's become a much huger business. The bean counters came in. The accountants came in. The lawyers came in. They figured out, well, if we, let's forget about all this freeform crap. The kids seem to be tuning into this heavy metal stuff here. So if we just play to the heavy metal audience, we know exactly who we're going to get. And that's our demographic and our age group. It's 14 to 19-year-old testosterone-crazed males. All right? And we'll, right before they get them for the army, we're going to stuck some money out of these guys. And they like that headbang shit. So the weirder the band, after they bite the head off a rat, that's our band, you know? And a lot of that went on. And what happened was, now, music used to, in the 60s, unite us. Used to hear Jimi Hendrix, the Beatles, Otis Redding, Janis Joplin, Rolling Stones, the Chambers Brothers, Iron Butterfly, Led Zeppelin, Joe Cocker, Wilson Pickett. It was all mushed up together. We liked all of it. We liked the whole thing. But if you go see a movie like Woodstock or Monterey, you see how many different kinds of popular music there was. There was folk, there was R&B, there was hard rock, there was metal, there was rock and roll, there was country rock, there was all kinds of stuff. We used to get that from radio. Now what happens is radio has become very demographed, very formatted, very rigid, very formulated, very structured. We're going to be AC. We'll just play to people who like music that isn't too loud. And, you know, every dentist office you go to plays, you know. And every dentist I go to, Billy Joel, hi. You know, you're that just the way you are guy. Come on in. You know, come on. Come on. Have I got some gas for you, you know? Okay, please, right away. It's okay, we're just going to play, we will just play new music. Well, I have some new music out. No, but you're old. Well, Lou Reed's older than me. Why are you playing him? Well, he's new old. Oh. Okay. You know. But we'll play Neil Young. But Neil Young is older than me. But he's alternative new old. Okay. You're too established. You are an AC artist. Wait a minute. If the Beatles came out now, they wouldn't know what to do with them. Just, when I get to the bottom, I go back to the top. I says, hell to Skelter! Charlie Manson goes, I'm going to kill people because of this song. Hell to Skelter! And it's and then they say, yesterday, oh, they're an AC band. Oh, my troubles seem so far. Okay, we'll only play the Beatles in the dentist office, okay? They played everything all over the place. What would they do with the Beatles? That's a good question. Could there be a Beatles now because of the way radio is? Maybe not. Maybe everything is so rigid. And I think in a way it's divided us from each other. I think, you know, I only like hard rock. Well, I only like alternative hard rock. Well, I only like heavy metal hard rock. Well, I only like American Guns N' Roses type hard rock. And I only like new alternative, well, American, but maybe English sometimes. Hard rock. It's so, like, you know, like little pigeonholes. And like, what are these people ever going to hear, you know, black music? You know, we will only play, we only play rap. We only play urban. Won't you play anybody who sings? You know, there's another oxymoron. Rap singer. You know? All right, what do you do? I'm a rap singer. Oh, so what do you do? You know, I don't understand a lot of it. A lot of it's gone beyond me. I'm very happy that I was able to get in the music business when I got in because it was wide open. On the other hand, the difference now is, okay, there's a lot of new bands out, and I think they're great bands, but the whole anti-star pose to me is a crock because, well, number one, why'd you make a record? Number two, why'd you make a video? Number three, You know, why are you doing this in the first place if you're so anti being, you know, you knew that there was going to be the ultimate result of doing what you're doing. And also, nowadays you got a better chance at making money going and being a musician than you do with a college diploma, okay? College diploma is no guarantee of a good job anymore. You know that. Come on, okay? You get your, I got that sheepskin. Yeah, I'll wait in line like everybody else. You know what I mean? Pearl Jam, come right along. Oh, come on, come on, come on. So, you know, this whole, I'm an outlaw and I'm anti this and, you know, like we're alternative. You know, give me a break. Give me a break. You're making good money, you know. Shut up. You know, it's a job. Let's call it what it is. Okay. Okay, I'm going to go right down the middle of the pike. You have a question?
Okay. We have about 20 questions we want to ask. Okay. Our ultimate dream, my friend and I here, is to go see you alone at a theater, just a piano, no band, and just singing your piano songs. Is that ever in your future, or I mean, what do you have locked in for what you want to do in your career in the next few years?
Okay. I've been thinking about that because I've said this is the last long tour I'm going to do. When I do a tour, I do like at least a year on the road, always. Even when I've been doing this now, so let's see, I started touring in my late teens, I say 20, I'm 44 now, so say 24, almost 25 years I've been touring. But every time I do a tour, it's at least a year. And I'm trying to think of another way of doing it because it's a long time to be out on the road, and I've seen the world, and I've stayed in the hotels, and I've done the arenas. I think we're good at it, but I'd like to do something new. I'd like to do something fresh. This kind of thing, I don't know if this is, if I could actually charge like big dollars for this kind of thing, but not that I want to charge like gouge people, but when I do a concert, we try to keep the ticket price $30 or under. Now, because we want to let younger people come in. Now, it rebounds on me, because what happens is the scalpers go, hey, Billy Joel's charging $30 and under. That's just great. We can get our hands on a shitload of Billy Joel tickets. And then they jack up the price and they sell to the, you know, the blue hairs who end up sitting in all the good seats and going, okay, show me, you know. And what I'm really trying to do is, like, we have a lot of younger people who want to come see us, but they can't because they get aced out by the scalpers. So we try to keep the ticket price down. I make a nice living, $30 more, you know, $28.50, it's fine, plenty of money. I could do fine. I hate scalpers. So I got a problem with that. And the more we play these arenas, the more I see these scalping problems, and the more I'm sick of these sons of bitches making a living off of my back and gouging the real fans. But, you know, it's up to the state to enforce the laws, and they got other fish to fry. So it's just tough. I mean, there's money going. You know it is. You know how it goes. There's all this shit. This is going on all over the place. The ticket distributor, they're getting their little thing. And, you know, I don't want to mention any names, but the people who have access to tickets, they get their little thing. And it's larcenous. I don't know what to do about it, and I thought maybe if I could get things smaller, I could keep it under control. I'd like to be able to play to rooms this size. It means I couldn't afford to pay a band because good musicians cost a lot of money. I couldn't have a big production. I could sit here and play a lot of piano songs, but that ain't it either. Maybe it's a mixture of playing more songs, but also doing something like this too. Because say I did this, you know, like every night, like I would do concerts, I would get different questions now, wouldn't I? Right? And it would keep it fresh, and it would keep it interesting. So something like this with more music, might be okay. Unfortunately, we're at the stage where we're not doing that more music thing yet. So you're a prototype, okay? Let's try another question. Okay, I'm going to go to the middle, right down the middle. The most middle person is...
How did you come up with the title for Root Beer Rag, and will you play it? Were you drinking
root beer?
You
want me to play the Root Beer Rag?
Yes. Were you drinking root beer at the time?
I love root beer. I don't know. I don't know how the hell I came up with that. I probably can't even play it anymore. Well, can't look in the lyric book for that one. That's an instrumental. Okay, a root beer rag. Hey, BR, put a little piano in the monitor because. Okay. To another key. That. Oh, I remember why I wrote this. I remember I got my first, you ever hear of a Moog synthesizer? This was in the mid-70s, and I got my first Moog, and I slopped on every record of this stupid Moog synthesizer thing. It's like, wah, 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 wah. I gotta write an instrumental where I can use this Moog synthesizer. Oh, I can put the Moog in there. Which kind of turned me off the synthesizers forever after. It sounds like a clarinet. That's why I wrote that song. Just purely out of total stupid self-indulgence is why I wrote that song. Listen to the recording again and you'll see there's this little Moog synthesizer like pissing all over it. Because I heard it again, I said, turn that thing off. How are we doing on time? Because this is a union house, yeah? I can't, what? It's only 8:30? It's a school night. Now it's time to say. It's 9 o'clock on a Saturday. The regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me, making love to his tonic and gin. Sure how it goes, but it's sad and it's sweet, and I knew it complete when I wore a younger man's clothes. La 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 di da, la la di da 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 da. Sing us a song, you're the piano man. Sing us a song tonight. Got us feeling all right.
is a friend of mine. He gets me my drinks for free. And he's quick with a joke, or to light up your smoke. But there's some place that he'd rather be.
He says, Bill, I believe this is killing me.
As a smile ran away from his face.
Well, I'm sure that I could be a movie star
if I could get out of this place.
La.
Now Paul is a real estate novelist who never had time for a wife. And he's talking with Davy, who's still in the Navy and probably will be for life. Is practicing politics as the businessmen slowly get stoned.
Yes, they're sharing a drink they call loneliness, but it's better than drinking alone.
And I just say, and the manager gives me a smile, 'cause he knows that it's me they've been coming to see, to forget about life for a while.
And the piano, it sounds like a carnival,
and the microphone smells like a beer.
And they sit at the bar and put bread in my jar and say, man, what are you doing here?
A song tonight.
While we're all in a mood for a melody,
you got us feeling all right.
Thank you, and good night to you.